Eurovision winners are rare to come by and are sometimes difficult to spot in a crowd of Balkan ballads and clean-cut Swedish pop. Yet somehow bookies, journalists and fans alike manage to find the diamond in the rough.
Points, that means that
how many plays in the slot? The pathway to becoming a Eurovision winner is long and winding and involves much more than 3 minutes of music. But for now, let's consider last year's winner, Arcade by Duncan Laurence, and how he did with the overall voting. The 50-50 split between jury and televoting has caused much controversy over the years, with the winner often not coming first in either. 2019 is no exception, with the Netherlands coming third in the jury and second in the televoting. Unfair? To some, maybe. But this equal opinion between fans and professionals is exactly what music producers want to achieve. Let's also look at the countries that came first and see how they fared. Songs like Spirit in the Sky is where controversy arises, and people shout out for the end of juries. An incredibly engaging song for the audience at home, but possibly seen as gimmicky, stereotypical Europop song to the juries, ticking every box on their love, love, peace, peace bingo. Whether you believe this or not, the lack of interest from the juries hit Norway hard in the voting. Now, when I was with my family during the jury voting, they were really surprised that North Macedonia was doing so well, while struggling to remember what the song was. Here lies another imbalance. Yes, you may have created the next James Bond song, but you only have 3 minutes packed tightly in between two countries trying their best to stand out too. You may be the best, but are you consistent? So, what made Arcade work so well? A broken heart is all. Well, if we analyze the song, we get to see the parts that it's made up out of, and see whether it's jury friendly, audience friendly, or that rare sweet spot in the middle of this Venn diagram. We immediately start the song with a time signature that isn't 4-4. However, the verse's 6-4 structure doesn't make the start jarring or off-putting to listeners. In fact, on my first listen, I didn't even notice that there was anything different. This is where the balancing act starts. 6-4 is a time signature that can really impress a jury, making a song complex or unique while retaining its accessibility to a wider audience. 6-4 is a time signature that you can really relate to, as it's close enough to 3-4 or 6-8 to remain neutral and natural. If they went too complex with something like 7-4 or even 5-4, then it would sound a lot more jarring to an audience lulled into a nice and simple 4-4 trance. They could have done worse though. You could have sent an a cappella group in 2019 because those famously do so well. So help me now. One thing that juries and televoters can agree on is that if you don't have on-point vocals live, then you ain't gonna make it far. My favorite example is Poland in 2018 with Light Me Up, an absolute banger of a track on paper, but let down by subpar fly falsetto and whatever those hand movements were. Now, obviously, Poland had other issues coming into the contest, and there are all sorts of things that could have held them back from the final, but this example is the one that I'm going to focus on. The song had issues transitioning from the studio to the stage. One of them, in my opinion, was going from heavily produced and altered vocals to live. No melodyne to save you there. This is where consistency comes into play. You've got to be able to deliver again and again, whether it's at the Café de Paris or Expo Tel Aviv. In fact, why don't we compare the... His vocals managed to fill both these venues almost effortlessly, hit every single member of the audience and doesn't even slightly falter. I mean, what else is there to say? Well, Duncan's voice and how it's utilized in the song helped the Netherlands in the jury in another way. Falsetto, lots of it. This episode of Earworm by Vox covers this phenomenon in popular music, seeing how male falsetto has grown in usage over the most recent decades. And there's some evidence to show you that the juries eat that stuff up for breakfast. Benjamin Ingrosso, Cesar Sampson, heck, you can even argue Ryan O'Shaughnessy qualifying for Ireland because of his ability to draw the attention of the jury alongside the audience at home. If you look at the history, they haven't qualified since 2013, where they came dead last. Only Jedward had better ranking in this decade.
Jedward!
Needless to say, this vocal style is loved by the masses, and the critics and this entry capitalized on this trend tenfold. Let's take a break from talking about Duncan and instead talk about... Let me give you some basic facts about this song, like I used to do when I was a small YouTuber all those... Oh, year ago. The tempo is a nice 72 beats per minute, fast enough to not bore you, but slow enough to either sway to or beat the ever-loving Christ out of your totally plugged-in piano. The key keeps it simple with an A minor and even simpler with its chord progression in the chorus. Some might consider this to be too simple, keeping with all the major chords and the root minor of the key, but let's be honest with ourselves, the average consumer couldn't care less about the chords. Only normal cover artists and weird people like me want to analyse every single inversion and moment of dissonance. And keeping it simple isn't uncommon in the chart-topping music either. Artists like Lana Del Rey, Jimi Hendrix, Bryan Adams and Adele have all used similar chord progressions in their songs, and the famous... progression isn't too far from this either. Whilst I'm sure juries love to hear the complexity and variation in these songs, I doubt the average person would like to hear a C7 with a flat ninth and a sharp fifth in their Schlagerfest. One thing commercial pop has to do these days is hook their audience in with repetition and interactivity. A catchy chorus with a synth motif you can hum is all some songs need to stay in your head for weeks. But how does it translate to the Eurovision stage? Well, Eurovision luckily has tens of thousands of people that all know the songs off by heart, including the interactive parts. Look at Mercy by Madame Monsieur with the hand movements, or Soldi with the... On TV sets around the world, this form of audience interactivity shines through, giving songs a new layer to it all. It invokes emotion, a sense of connection and togetherness, sometimes for good causes. Now, before I go too melodramatic about it, let's see how Duncan gets the crowd going. The Netherlands went with a We Will Rock You route and got the audience to join in with stomps, claps and chanting. I mean, hey, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. This pattern and melody starts off every chorus, so everyone listening to the song knows how it goes, and therefore joins in. Hearing a stadium full of people singing their lungs out for their own enjoyment is almost enough to distract me from the fact that he is properly hitting that poor piano. Has no one else ever talked about this at all? He is properly destroying that piano. Poor thing. It's these moments that get played again and again, sticking out in people's minds when it comes to vocal. In fact, my friend always hates the songs that have the oohs and ahs in them, finding them so boring and repetitive and almost in every song that she hears. However, when it comes to the show, she always says, "I like that song that goes," and then proceeds to sing the ooh or ah bit. I mean, if that's not proof that they were, then God knows what is. Another moment to audiences love is... This is less about the song and more about the staging, so I won't dwell on it, but if the song wasn't structured in the way it is, you wouldn't have these amazing moments. I'm talking Jamala with the tree, I'm talking Mons with the neon gnomes, I'm talking Duncan with the weird light orb thing. Whether you consider it genius or gimmicky, you can't deny that it works. Having these amazing moments to go back to on replays catches the eyes of the average watcher, makes them think, oh yeah, that's the one with the light ball, I'll vote for that one. It's a gorgeous piece of minimalism in a contest that's famous for its big, loud atmosphere. An arresting moment, calm before the storm. It sure worked with Salvador Sobral, but why not with Duncan Laurence? And this brings me to my final point. This amazing contest keeps on evolving and surprising us, with its ups and downs and everything in between. Come the new year, it is all to play for, with realistically any country being able to win the crown, minus the UK maybe. Eurovision is a whole balancing act, with hundreds of people in various different roles coming together under one flag to create a 180-second spectacle. When it's phrased like that, the whole video may sound redundant, but if you keep this in mind leading up to May, you may be surprised by the outcome. Thank you very much for watching. Please leave a like and consider subscribing to ESCplus if you want more videos like this for Eurovision 2021. And since the post-Eurovision depression may be stronger this year than any other, mainly because it didn't happen, you might need some new music to listen to. Luckily for you, I make music, and my new song Columbia is out everywhere on May 24th. I hope you check it out, and I hope to see you here again very soon. See ya!